agenda? I don't think I have a hard copy.
Not a hard, did it just come across like today?
No, I sent it to everybody on
I'll share.
Okay.
Can I?
Absolutely. All right. Public comment period, there's no one to, here to speak for the public, so we'll pass that on and move to approval minutes. FYI, poor Terry has been suffering from an undiagnosed illness for a long time. It's caused her a lot of fatigue and other symptoms, and she's finally been diagnosed with mononucleosis. So she's fallen behind on the minutes, understandably. So even though she has caught up with the last 2 minutes, she just now got them. So I would rather us not spend precious meeting time reviewing minutes. So I'm gonna send them out electronically tonight. At least one set?
Yeah.
Oh, one set, okay. And then the other set as soon as we can. And so we're just gonna punt that forward a little bit for a wee longer.
So we'll approve them now.
So we'll approve minutes and the next one. All right, chair report. You know what I'm realizing? See, this is why I need people to remind me about this agenda, is that I forgot to give you time on this agenda, Rich. No, it's not fine.
I have nothing to add.
Really? Really?
No.
Okay, but I can cut mine short because I don't think I'll take 15 minutes. So if you have even something little to say, please do. All right, so chair report, we're going to see Terry in a half an hour. And the next person I'd like to invite with your consent is Chris Mason, who is the Energy and Sustainability Officer for the city of Huntington. And one of the reasons why this struck me as a person who I think we need to talk to sooner than later is that Molly Freilicher forwarded me a draft ordinance that is circulating in the city of Greenfield right now. And one of the aspects of the ordinance has to do with solar arrays. And it said that public trees cannot be planted anywhere that would interfere with solar arrays, including solar arrays that are planned. And that felt really strong to me. And I feel like, you know, we need to have a conversation about that. And, you know, Chris is involved in a lot of putting together solar array projects for the city of Northampton. And I know this has come up before, and I know it's going to come up in the future because I have a particular neighbor who is already interested in removing a public tree, that fully grown, mature shade tree that would interfere with her solar reception. So I would love to get in front of this conversation. Is that okay? I mean, we can talk to him about other things, like all the areas we agree on, because I think there's going to be way more areas of commonality than potential conflict, but that really just struck me. So, all right, I'll invite him if everyone's okay with that. Okay. So I made a big media launch in advance of the fall planting and the Survey Monkey. A number of us have been interviewed by the Gazette. The Gazette is going to be running a pretty extensive article on us, which is really great. And I think with the theme of here's where we were a year ago, citizens were really pushing the city to create a tree program, and we were taking it upon ourselves to do a sample tree inventory, and we're a year later, look at all the great things that happened. So that is coming, and they're also going to mention our Survey Monkey, which already has 200 responses, so we're doing really great.
When we talk to the press, and this is kind of like long-term strategy, I think there's a lot of education that needs to take place in the world. I think kind of developing that message, like, even if it doesn't make it through every time, it would be nice to try to insert it into a discussion. Because, I mean, it is kind of, anytime you have a board that has like specific, limited, but broad goals, it's easy to get confused with what
you're doing. Yeah, no, that's a good suggestion. I don't know if any of the folks who got interviewed drove that point home. I think I think in all the press releases, I've been really careful about using the words public shade tree, and in the Survey Monkey, public shade tree. But you're right, I mean, people see tree, and so they think that we have some kind of jurisdiction over all trees in this.
This is something.
Yeah, I think actually that dovetails with the conversation I'd like us to have about the letters to the responders.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll that could fall under other business. All right, and then LOI, did that go out, Rich?
No.
What's over?
The
Letter.
Letter of intent to department.
Oh. To the grant.
Yeah, okay. All right, and then what do we got? Tomorrow morning, I specifically put this on the agenda very explicitly, that we're doing a planting site tour with the following people at the following time. To really be careful about the open meeting thing, since there are three of us, and the city's been understandably taking a lot of heat about open meeting law. I don't know if you can follow.
Has Alan spoken to you about site visits? Is this on, like, when we do this, site visits for gathering data are usually exempt from open meeting law.
Yeah.
I don't know how Alan interprets it, but my understanding is that if you're like, oh, there's a tree, and you're not like, well, I think it's a bad tree, and as long as you're not deliberating, which is that fine line, but you're gathering data, my understanding is that for some of the conditions, and I couldn't be completely wrong, but the way I've read it, the way it's interpreted to me, is that as long as you're just gathering data, it's okay.
So that's how it always operated when I was on the Community Preservation Committee, too, because we did a lot of site visits. But I think the city is just really trying to be hyper careful. And so what he advised Rob, because Rob inquired about this.
I did speak to him about this specifically.
Was to just put it on our agenda so that it's posted, that we're doing this site visit. And it's not like we're inviting the public to come along, but it's just really like transparent that we are conducting a triple site visit.
And which site visit is this tomorrow?
This is tomorrow morning, so the following people you see on that list are touring around Northampton to look for potential sites for planting. Do you remember that the last meeting we generated a list of criteria?
Yes.
So we're taking that list and we're taking it on the road, and we're going to actually try to come up with lots of very specific sites where we want to plant. And I can't invite anyone else to come along because we got three people on the committee and four women. You could. I would love
now
to
I'm
just
keep
it.
I'm already in the back, you know, slapping the roof.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what we're doing tomorrow. And one of the things I did want to say about that is I've also been in conversation with the city school system, and they're going to send me a list of high priority sites where kids, where bus stops are, or there are major walk to school routes. So we're going to try to incorporate that. I don't know if we're going to have that in the morning, but I basically, in an email to you guys, recapped everything I believe that we mentioned for priority sites, and we're going to do that. Like gateways, strategic spots downtown, key intersections, cluster planting, walk to school routes, South Street. Yeah, I mean, nothing but what we generated as a group at the last meeting. So I'm ahead of schedule. Rich, I'm sure you don't have anything you'd like to.
Just talking about the planting ride tomorrow. We're taking a third delivery tomorrow from Bigelow Nursery Trees, so we have to take delivery from Northeast and Sherbo Nursery, so they're in our holding area. The Google Doc map that Andy and I have been working on, the map is, I should say, the fields in the Google Doc have pretty much been set. They can be edited, but for the time being, put them in a place in order of how they would go if I was to use the map. So basically, I took the spreadsheet that I used to have in Excel, and I used it. So all the information is being entered in Google Doc. So that link that I sent you last week, you should be able to look at it, it's been populated with all the tree planting locations that we have presently listed on there, and I'm adding to it going along. But it also has places where trees have been planted in the past, going this past for 1 year. It has proposed locations that have been put on there, which is the list that I made from years past of tree removal. And then accepted is the other field that we have for trees that are accepted, they're all color coded stars.
Accepted means we're definitely planting them.
Yes, so for a resident, ask for a tree to a location, try to comment that person. I'm on the waiting list, so I think after tomorrow, Brian will probably know a little more about what the field is accepted, which, you know, proposed. We can just build a proposed field, and we can debate which place we want to plant our trees, and that will be the accepted. So, it's a work in progress, you know, it's just gonna take some time, that's all. But he was able to migrate everything, well, I didn't do any extra data entry, so it didn't require any of my time, Terry's time, my entry. Now on, I'm gonna use that document as our document for, basically, absolutely, planting trees. I would like to populate it with trees we planted in years past, so I'm gonna try to go back and have Andy populate that, so we have kind of a broader census for planted trees over the years.
Yeah.
So, it's just, for the short term, I think, in order to get us off the ground, just a year is enough.
Right, until the inventory takes.
Yeah.
For tomorrow, what's our kind of interaction with that, or are we paper maps, or?
I think the easiest thing to do is, I mean, I hope that all of you bring to the table a location that you already have in your mind that you wanted to look at. And I think what we should do is just actually take a tour of those places and have a conversation about them, and actually document them on paper. It's gonna be easier to document them on paper, and then I can actually just bring the information back to the office and send it.
Are y'all gonna be looking between, like, at downtown and King Street?
Are we looking, well, we have a list here that actually really already kind of prioritizes on the bottom half of the agenda, but these are locations that you're gonna look at.
Oh, yeah, I put them on here.
So you kind of put them on here roughly, so.
And they're not in a particular order.
Right.
This is just, this was the list we generated last, when we got together the last.
So the quick and easy thinking is, right, replanting sites and appropriate requested sites, that's really easy, you can very have that. So.
And I expect you're gonna get with the Gazette.
Oh, yeah, I've been getting emails from people, so they're requesting. Entering the information in there is proposed, so I think we should probably concentrate on going to places below number one. You know, places where sidewalks exist, obviously we'll be looking at all those places, but strategic map visibility sites and gateways. And then looking at those locations, determining whether or not we would consider planting clusters or planting clusters of multiple trees in one location, however you want to space them out.
During that site visit, would it be possible to determine a location that we could plant like 3 or so trees for when we do the training on the 12th?
Sure.
So, I mean, in my mind, I thought, oh, that swale down on Con Street has very high visibility and easy to park, you know, I guess we'll have to ask the Gazette if we can park in the parking lot, but.
So when you say cluster, they could be like 3 houses in a row. They don't have to be.
For example, like Stoddard Street, I have a lot of requests for trees on Stoddard Street, so that's a location we've lost a lot of trees, and we've replanted there, but replanting was successful. So that would be like a good cluster, you know,
okay.
Kind of just as an example.
Mm-hmm.
There's other ones like that as well. Lily Street is another example in Florence. Unfortunately, it has a really very narrow tree belt, which is probably not much wider than this table. So that would be a location where you think about doing some different, like offering setback areas, things of that. So I mean, there's different clusters that you could work in. But I think one of the things I just want to make sure is that we make sure that we try to spread out the wealth in a sense of where we place these trees, so everyone feels. Because I don't want people to walk away this year and say, okay, the Public Safety Commission planted all the trees over here, and I've been asking for a tree for 3 years.
Yeah.
I was promise to you.
No.
In the spirit of cooperation, try to make everybody feel included or inclusive.
I'm wondering if for everyone who requests a tree, we can extract from them, maybe in writing, a promise that they will water the tree. I mean, you know, notwithstanding some reasonable exceptions like elderly people or something, but it just seems to me like a really nice quid pro quo and an opportunity to engage people and for them to feel the ownership of the tree. And it does release the city of some of that extra work of having to maintain 160 trees.
It's a lot of water.
It's a lot of water. What do people think about that idea?
Well, the setback trees that are already required.
Well, we can't water setback trees.
Right.
So.
That's good.
But I'm actually even talking about trees on this right away. I mean, if someone, because if someone's requesting the tree, they're like going the extra mile there.
Right.
And they're already self-selected for probably caring about trees.
Mm-hmm. So would we maybe be using the alligator, I mean, Chris has ordered a lot of alligator bags, so would we be using them and asking them to fill the alligator bag? Because I think that would be good. I just observed that when people water with those, the water doesn't sort of come down into the tree. And so, I mean, not that when I water, but they don't maintain the berm, and they don't measure the water they're putting in.
Yeah,
they go out and they turn the hose on and they get the top like half inch wet and then they leave.
So that's an education piece. That seems to be like a pretty easy education piece.
I think if we're going to ask you, we're going to ask you to water trees, is supply them able to water bag and be with some kind of tag of some sort that basically explains how to operate this. You know, do this but don't do this.
Mm-hmm.
Don't set the hose on full blast and be pointing it at the bark mulch. Because then you're going to, you know, create possibly an air pocket, and so on and so forth, those kinds of things, you know. And I think people, especially people that are in the country, so why need to water them?
Yeah, okay.
And how much, like, my students are amazed at, like, I'm like, yeah, 2 5-gallon buckets. They're like,
right.
What?
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, 2 5-gallon buckets,
right.
You know?
But the
right.
The bag kind of solves that problem. Mm-hmm. There's a certain amount of water in the bag. It's all the same. And I know their bags aren't popular with some people.
I've been 2 miles in the bags. One, I think they're good, but I think they're also heat sinks.
And Alan thinks that they're bacteria traps.
I think it's bacteria and heat, and I think it's not necessarily a good thing that they're like on there. Maybe it's a couple of rotting living apart.
Yeah.
I mean, the research is there.
What do you think, Jen?
Anyway, it's not like it's going to hurt if they haven't filled up, but I don't think it's... I'm curious to see if maybe there's like one or two places where you can just like use it, like air and grass, because I'm not entirely convinced that it's going to use
the city's been using them for five years, and...
I mean, you have more problems with trees dying because of the strange weather we've had, harsh winters and dry summers like this. Not anywhere. You can see trees are dropping their leaves left and right,
yeah.
And it's only, I don't know, it's September, but it's because of the weather we've had. So, I mean, I don't really have an opinion either way, other than it takes a lot of guesswork out of it. You know, there's no guesswork in it. So the water bag's full, great. Oh, the water bag's empty. I'm going to fill it up today. And so there's not that, if you go by the tree and there's nothing there, you go by the tree and there's, you don't think about it. But you see the water bag, you're like, oh,
it's true, it is a cue.
It's a cue, so if we're trying to get people to do this.
All right, and the city really can provide all those water bags? Okay, well then, I mean, why don't we give it a try?
We have over half already. I have most of them already.
Recommendation of those, it might not happen here, probably, but we found some times to be really successful. It's a way to keep them from disappearing. It's not like there's like a big resale value for the bags, but sometimes you can just force them out.
Yeah.
It's that extra step.
It actually makes our job easier because if we're not able to get residents to buy in, then all I have to do is pull up with a 1,000-gallon tanker truck we have. It takes one guy, you can just fill them up. It's very cost-effective for personnel and time-wise.
Yeah.
Instead of staying there with a hose and trying to dial it down and make sure that we're not, you know, making a hole in the ground.
Yeah. Okay, all right, but let's go back to the question of, do we want to try to engage people in the water? I mean, I understand that there's an efficiency of having the crew do it, but we're trying to create, like, a citizen engagement. So, you know, it's certainly not going to make your guys' work any further to remove some of the trees from their list of trees that need to water. Do people like the general concept of asking folks, if you're requesting a tree and we're putting a tree in front of your yard, and this is not on the setback. The setback, your water, you're definitely volunteering to water the tree, but on the public right-of-way, we're asking people, if they're going to get a tree in front of their yard, if they're requesting it, to please water that tree.
I think it's a good idea.
I have some...
Yeah, I would not check on it.
You would not check?
I would not check.
I would not check.
Not check on it. All right, let me, you know, I visited Worcester's Tree Initiative Group about a year ago, and they had some really good literature, some good education stuff about watering trees, so I'll try to put together something like, for example, they calculated how much the average person would spend over the course of an entire summer watering a tree. It's like $2.27.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, that kind of thing might make some people feel better about, oh, this is not a huge outlay of resources.
I don't typically think the people that are actually requesting trees are going to have a problem with it.
Yeah.
They wouldn't request it in the first place.
We've had...
That's not my experience.
But they might assume that somebody else is doing it. So if we just go that extra step...
About how many people have requested a tree? Like, a dozen, a couple of them?
I would say altogether, probably 20.
Okay, not that many.
No, but I mean, that's accumulation. I had to go back and add it all. Other residents that have asked for two trees. Some residents that I owe trees to, from the previous year, trees, they're being sold on term. So those people are all for watering their own trees. So, why the trees don't have to be right away?
We've had a few people respond to the tree planting volunteer thing, that they didn't feel like they could plant, but they were willing to just be waterers.
Yeah.
So there's probably a handful of people on that list.
And I gotta tell you, the survey, you know, asked if the people would be willing to volunteer at different capacities. That's completely blown away.
Volunteer generally?
By the number of people who are saying I'm willing to volunteer in some capacity or another. And so, you know, we have a huge cognitive really. All right, it's almost 4:30. Is there anything else, Rich, that you wanted to mention?
No.
Did anything end up happening with the questions about the lindens? The people...
The Smith lindens.
Yeah. I have a meeting with the mayor on Friday at 10 o'clock, but I'm also waiting to speak with Jay Maltis as well.
I was just curious.
Yeah, I've been getting the final answers.
So, kind of, whatever answers I get from you. So there were a lot of objections. Basically, the trees are to be the trees, pay the trees is in the mayor's hands. So there are multiple objections.
And I'm looking to do it right now.
With the trees?
Yeah. You're losing a lot of trees.
Yes.
The old ones or the new ones? The lindens?
The lindens.
Are your guys watering right now the trees?
Yes. Yep. The trees we planted from last year were watered. Well, the trees we took in the new trees we have?
Well, both.
Yes, every day.
Okay. Can I ask a quick question? This might not be related to our work, but since it is tree related, any news on the park? When that's going to get
this? Pulaski Park?
Yeah. Because it still looks like not.
The contract's been signed, and they had a pre-construction meeting, but I am not. I thought it was supposed to start, I think, maybe next week or the week after.
Oh.
Because they're going to be putting in a bunch of construction.
Yeah.
Mountain View Landscaping is awarded the bid.
Where are they from?
Chickadee. Somewhere in Chickadee, Lovell. So, yeah. Very good, very reputable company.
It's the largest landscape company. company in Massachusetts.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely Western Mass.
Depends what they said. Both sides of them.
Yeah.
Are they the ones who take the votes?
Some, yeah, last year they did a lot of work in Spain. One job worked out fine, the other job worked out terrible.
We're just waiting for Terry. Feel free to, you know, chat.
I was down in Cape May, New Jersey over the weekend. I don't know if you've ever been to Cape May proper, but they have, you know, it's a historic area with a lot of Victorian homes. The most amazing tree belt I think I've seen in America, mostly sycamores, and just total canopy the whole way. And yes, there are power lines on those side of the street.
And the canopy goes up and over?
Yeah. It looks like this amazing, like, careful, you know, piece of land.
So the tree line, the trees are going to go up?
No, the power lines are kind of tucked in, you know, in various places, and, you know, there's no big hole cut out of the tree. Obviously, there's a snow lot down there, but it is a nice example of power lines and very mature trees interacting in the same space.
I have to say, I've seen that in numerous cities. Washington, D.C. is a great case of that. So I don't always buy the argument that you can't plant a tree that will become a large tree. I know people disagree with me on this.
Within a block of my house, there are three ginkgos planted in tree belts. I don't know who planted them, but they're all getting, one got up the power line and about 5 feet over it, and the power company cut it off. Two are approaching the power line. I think maybe it would be good, I mean, like, to negotiate with them ahead of time about leaving the ginkgos to go over the power lines. Is that feasible, Rich?
It's feasible because he's supposed to file documentation. They're planning on pruning circuits. They're supposed to do all that. And I've got, but hands right now, it's all set. They're going to start another line of that probably either this winter or spring, another circuit. So plants get some information.
So would it be possible for someone to know which area that is and then go look at what kind of trees to you that
sure
might go?
And that's part of the reason why we need right there.
Right.
And that's supposed to be public. Yeah.
We're supposed to file that with, you know, supposed to get an approval as well. I mean, but for years it was done under my tutelage, you could say, but I wasn't a tree warden. So that was that kind of cloudy area where it was, the tree warden was the committee, but it was a form. So that was back then.
Because I'm following up what Todd said, just thinking about it, I do see the opportunity for these trees to interact with power lines in the same way.
And what was the width of the tree belts? Right. Also Washington, D.C. Huge willow oaks. You know, they're, parts of the roots are just sort of like folding over the sidewalk, but the sidewalk is still, like, they manage the sidewalk pretty darn well. And they are healthy, really, really healthy trees.
Yeah. Well, it's all open grass, so unlike our downtown where we bring from that area, you know, this is, it's a very urban setting, but it's all, you know, it's an open grass area, so at least they get that, you know, water from that area.
What the tree looks like on South Street, like, you know, there are a lot of places where we have tree belts that are open,
Does anyone want to run over and grab Terry? Okay. While he's doing that, I wanted to ask you, I set up a free survey monkey, but then I learned, they always kind of, you know, reel you in, that you can only access the first 100 responses for free. And you have to actually buy a monthly plan for anything in excess of 100. And what I learned, though, is that we can buy just a one month. And it's going to cost $26.
Okay.
We're already at 194 responses, more than 24 hours. Okay. It seems to me like $26 really well spent.
Wayne must have an account because he's used SurveyMonkey the best, correct?
you know, had I thought of that, I would have done this through Wayne's office, but now I don't think that I can migrate this to Wayne's account.
No, so we'll have to find out from him how he set it up, so.
Okay, all right.
And I'm sure that we'll probably be utilizing this again.
Well, if you're utilizing it again, then it might behoove you to buy a gear plan, but it's, you know, then you're talking several hundred dollars. So anyway, I just wanted to say, oops, sorry.
I didn't know that about surveys.
If you need me to write a donation check.
Just as long as it's money, not a tree.
Okay, Terry Masterson, welcome to the Northampton Public Shade Tree Commission. If folks want to quickly go around and introduce yourselves, we have fancy nameplates. But you might be interested to know that there's some folks that have, you know, that are thinking about and have professional experience thinking about economic activity. It really is true.
Lumber?
You know Todd?
Yeah, we know.
Oh, okay.
No, you can do that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Rob Postle. Rich Parsley.
Hey, Rich.
Hi, Terry. How you doing?
Okay.
Terry. Hi, Terry. I'm Mary.
Jay Gerard, certified arborist.
And Andrew, do you
want to
just tell
them? Oh, yeah, I do a lot of work down at the Urban Forestry Program in Honolulu, greening the UAC cities, so it's kind of involved in Urban Forestry.
Lily Lombard?
Jen Werner, I'm teaching the Landscape Design and Management Program at Springfield Technical Community College. I've been in this industry for 30 years.
I do.
That's right. I do.
Mr. Suzer.
Oh yeah, Mr. Suzer. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, the big guns. Yeah.
So as I said in my email to you, we are taking the time early in our formation to create relationships with all of the city employees who feel work, you know, overlaps with our mission, which is to expand and protect our public shade tree canopy. And I think I also sent you a link to an article that shows a strong correlation between tree-lined streets and heightened retail activity. I know personally, I feel that all the time. Like, I'd much rather walk down Strong Avenue, which is, like, you know, lined with honey locusts, than turn onto King Street and head in that direction, where I know I'm going to be facing full, you know, unrelenting sun. So we just wanted to see what your thoughts are. And since we are undertaking a pretty big planting this fall, and it's only the first year of hopefully many years of really intensified plantings, that we'd love to hear what you think is a strategic approach from the perspective of increasing our economic activity.
Well, I think that planting the trees for me is extremely important. I think aesthetic is a very, very important part of an area's attractiveness, its quality of life. And certainly from an environmental perspective, there's a whole other series of progressive reasons to increase the level of vegetation anyway. But from a point of view of commerce, I too agree totally that the aesthetic of trees and shrubs and bushes and flowers and plantings are extremely important. I think, just as an aside, I mean, clearly, I don't agree with them, but older business owners like King Street, for them, trees are simply, you know, camouflage that blocks you from seeing all their pretty colors. cars and their shiny corporate logos. So you'll always get that, you know, and obviously King Street's more of a drivable, you know, looking from a car window, so there'll also be, you know, that response from some of them that, you know, there's really no need for trees. But alternatively, as someone who travels through Maryland and Virginia and New Jersey, you know, pretty much on a frequent basis, it's amazing in Virginia and Maryland what they do with shopping centers and retails and downtowns in terms of shrubs and bushes and trees and flowers. There's no question that that's a priority for them. And why that, and you don't see that as someone like myself who grew up in Westchester County, it's like you don't even see that. Put up the building, grow the parking lot, end of story, project completed, and you just go, you know, go block after block in Westchester where that's the level of commitment to green. So you don't have an advocate for me totally. And as you know also in my email, I'd like to talk to the city about lining some of the exteriors of our parking spots with hedges and shrubs. The trees to me aren't enough. I think some places you really want to create green belts to further make the downtown look more attractive, as opposed to constantly turning every corner and there's a wall of automobiles facing you. It'd be more attractive to try to, you know, frame those surface lots in some more vegetation if the budget allows it. I'd like to talk to the city all about that.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I was in Westchester the other day, because I was down in Virginia this weekend, and I took some photographs of two particular real estate properties that were engaged with shrubs and berms and hedges, and I'll try to email you those photographs to give you an idea visually what I'm talking about, what I think you all are well aware of.
It does. You know, when you mentioned berm, it made me think instantly of a development project that was just completed here in Northampton, that is on Conn Street with that new hotel, and how they created this very high berm where they put a bunch of birch trees on top. Do you know what I'm talking about? And I look at it and I go, not so much. You know, it didn't really work, and I don't know, like, was that, I think that's in the public right-of-way, and I don't think it achieves those visual, maybe, goals that it was trying to have, except for that they probably got in the number of trees that they were supposed to get in. But I didn't know if there is some aesthetic guideline that they were following to build that up so high. What's the one I'm referring to?
I totally did.
Do you like it?
It's interesting.
Well, and then plunked right by it is that, you know, there's big barriers that are protecting an electrical area. Anyway, so I feel like, you know, we can put these specifications in and developers can still get it really wrong. And so I'm just wondering what kind of influence we can have so that we help them achieve the broader goal beyond their just satisfying what they need to do for permitting.
One of the important parts of my job is to deal with business owners and communicate with them, and I've done that for a lot of part of my life. I'm someone who prides himself pretty much on trying to communicate the difficult things to stakeholders in ways that they can accept and understand the logic behind them. But I think, and I say this hesitantly, but I think with some of the boards that we may have here, and this comes to me from many of the developers and the real estate brokers, there's a, you must do this, and you must do this. And I don't think that's the best way to have a conversation sometimes. And I think particularly when you're trying to impress upon these stakeholders that these are things that benefit them as well, it's sometimes better to have that conversation. So I agree with what you're saying. And in that particular property, I think there was a long process of you must do this, you must do that, this must go here, but that must go there, and
And I lamented when I heard about it after I had arrived, it's only been in 2 years, to say that really could have been done in a more, you know, sidebar, yeah, exactly, manner, because the owner of the hotel is a longtime, you know, person here, and knows, gets these messages, and understands them. It's not like it's a hard message to send. So how you send it sometimes makes a difference. Because it gets really, really are important, important goals to try to promote. I mean, the other point I would make, which I'm fine, I don't know how to diplomatically bridge, is that I see some real estate properties in downtown that are really well landscaped, and there's some that are just horribly landscaped, and I just don't know how to tell that entity, you know, the chain link fences and the lack of vegetation, and I'll tell you a funny story. When I was in Westchester County, there were a number of conference centers. General Electric has a conference center in Croke, New York. It's hidden away in the middle of the woods. Nobody can see it, and that's just the way they want it, because for them, in their corporate culture, they want to take you out of the Fairfield headquarters or wherever and put you in a place where all you're concerned about is the thought of thinking about whatever that product or service or corporate challenge is. So when you go into GE, it's landscaped and shrubbed and hedged and flowered. I mean, you think you're in a country club, and it's all done deliberately. Citibank has a conference center right next to the Westchester County Airport, but it's on a very busy road. And one day I got a chance to get a tour of it. You come off this road, and it's like a whole bunch of traffic. You come in through the main gate, and the minute you pass the gate, you don't really realize it from the road, but you do once you get in, you're completely submerged in this wall of trees and vegetations and plants and flowers, and you hear nothing in there. You are like in a whole other world. And in terms of bringing people into a hotel or to an office building, that's part of the experience. So if you don't have a property that's properly landscaped from the outside, it affects the value of the property, I think. But to convey that to people isn't, you think I'm crazy telling you,
No, I think a lot of it is the design that goes into it. It comes up with the design, quality of the design, makes that work or not work.
And again, I mean, there's a whole subset of environmental and land use reasons for this, but I'm focusing right now on more of the commercial, what to me, for me, the aesthetic point of view of just having attractive properties has a value of its own too. But for the marketing of those properties, you want it to look like the Augusta National Golf Course. I mean, to just be, you know, blunt. I mean, you want it to look proper. I mean, look at this weekend. I noticed the last 2 weekends, the amount of flowers that the Hotel Northampton has outside, it's amazing. It's gorgeous. Has anybody?
Oh, my daughter's a real plant freak, and every time she passes there, she does two things. She praises them for beauty, and she laments the fact that no one is putting hanging flowers along the Main Street anymore. And for her, like that, that's what it felt like. It felt like an extension of Hotel Northampton up and down the street. So what percent would you say of property owners in downtown do you suspect buy into the concept of shade trees benefiting their bottom line? Like, it really being in their best interest. And how can we bring that number up and get more buy-in from them?
I honestly don't know. I could start to talk and speak to that, try to ascertain what some of the perceptions are. I mean, obviously, some may feel it's blocking their store. They don't want to, they may have some reluctance about it, but I don't know, Todd can speak to it, because Todd's been on the bid board and been engaged on the DNA committee, so he's as close to the fireplace as I am. I don't mean that in a negative way, I just mean it's close to that issue. I mean, again, personally for me, I think a treeless downtown would be a disaster. I mean, but I'm just speaking for me. I would think that is the last thing we want.
Do you think one positive thing we could do as a commission is try to bring up the education level about that well-documented research between tree-lined streets and economic activity? would that, do you think that would be helpful? And I'm just wondering how we go about that. And the other is, do you feel like if we did raise that education bar, do you get the sense that any of these businesses would be willing to contribute to the bottom line, contribute to a tree planting program, contribute to the cost of having to replace? See, because a lot of these trees just don't survive well in downtown. We had this discussion about how it's almost pointless to replant some trees in the same old tree coffins, because they're just not going to survive any more than the last 10 that we tried to plant there. And so there is some just reinvestment in a new kind of setting for the trees that needs to happen. And, you know, currently the city does not have a budget.
Well, I'll give you an example, and you tell me what you think of it and how you approach it. And Rich is familiar with this. And I see both sides of the coin. The gentleman that owns the old Bay State Hotel building, where Sierra Grill is, and I guess there's three retail venues in that building. He is very, and I don't know where that issue is today, but he reached out to me several times, like a year ago, last summer, because he was very opposed to the trees on Storm Avenue.
It's just so funny that I just mentioned that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'm not bringing it up for that reason, but it's always good to see what's on both sides of the coin. So from his perspective, he saw the trees on Strong Avenue as the fact that he's not wrong. He sees his building as not being on prime Main Street. He sees his building as being off Main Street. He sees it as being on a side street. And he sees the Main Street down the road as that's where all traffic is, and if there's this row of trees, nobody can see his building and see where he is. So he wants to have that visual connection, and you can understand that. So I don't know how you, I don't know, I didn't know what to try to say to him to, you know, counter what he was saying. I mean, I could see the logic behind it. I think no trees on Strong Avenue just adds to the urbanity of downtown, and I don't think that anybody wants that. So, speaking for myself, I see value trees, but I can see the business perspective of others that don't. And so I just don't expect you to answer it either, but to answer your question, it's one anecdote that I could express of somebody who, you know, was more motivated not to want to have it. He was even willing, I don't know if Rich can speak to it if anything more came of it, he was willing to come and talk to any board so that he would pay to replace these trees and put other types of smaller, more modest trees in the tree lines. And that's what he was willing to do.
He just wanted to cut them down.
Yeah.
He was willing to replace them.
Those are just starting to get their story.
Given the
nature of
lack of difficulty of replacing trees in downtown,
No, you don't know. I'm just telling him what he was claiming he would be.
So we tried to satisfy him. We came down, we put in the trees a couple of times to try to raise them up the canopy, because what's happening is they interfere with the deck where people sit for Molinos.
Right.
And for the venue that's at the top floor. So it's just a matter of trying to work with folks, but it's kind of a challenge, given that people really want to see, you know, they want their storefront or their venue to be seen by people. But, you know, I'm really reluctant to cut any trees down anywhere downtown.
Pardon?
I said I'm very reluctant to cut any trees down. Just really, because it's so hard to find the trees that'll stay, you know, be established for a long period of time.
Other questions?
There's been studies, like statistics, or sheet statistics on, you know, benefits. Would that be benefits of trees related to commerce? You know, would that be useful for your department to have? You know, just I don't know, as a
right,
handout or something. You know what I mean?
Something on the ready.
Yeah.
I don't, well, sure, I'll be happy to have it, but I can say that I don't
fortunately, my phone doesn't ring with tree appointments. And I mean that positively. I don't think Todd can speak to it. We've never been at meetings where people, the store owners have said we don't want trees in downtown. So I'd say that as a positive. I would, one angle of advocacy is to find scholarship that points out consumer preferences for green downtowns, to find scholarship that indicates what Northampton citizens want to see in their downtown.
Yeah.
So that if you do see a store owner who's an opponent, you can sort of say, these are your customers. This is what your customers want to see. And if they don't see a nice welcoming green downtown with flowers and lights and seasonal plantings, they'll go shop someplace else. They're just not going to feel attracted to one down there or go for a walk. You come here on a Friday, Saturday night, walking is like the second hobby. It's to go eat dinner, get dessert, and then walk around. And if it's, you know, a cement canyon, that obviously, doesn't make it a walkable, attractive place.
But you said on King Street, it's different. There's the automobile section of King Street. The business owners feel the trees are a disruption to their son.
I can't say that I have direct evidence to that effect, but, and I'm not, because to me, I think there's like a, in front of the, where the Cole Morgan property was, where the Volkswagen dealer is, there's now double rows of trees, which I think is terrific. I think that works. I mean, I don't think that as a drive-by, you're not going to know it's a Volkswagen dealership. I mean, so to me, and the double row of trees is just going to add to creating more, perspective on the street. So I see, but I'm just echoing what's.
But maybe, as Dan suggested, maybe you have some literature, because I know that like one dealership in the half price is their trees. So that might just indicate that there's a little bit of problem.
I'll give you a specific anecdote. Chip Robertson was the property manager for Leah Honda. Leah Honda left the site on Lower King Street to go to further north. Chip Robertson is a very well outspoken, vinegar tongue, bark is worse than his bite, very gruff guy, and he reflects the culture of the Leah Honda dealerships in the area. He lectured me on end about when he went before planning board for approval of the new Honda site. They didn't just tell him that he had to have trees, they had to specify what kind of trees and what kind of variety, and he just thought, I get the trees, why are you telling me, he thought it was red tape. And he then went further, and he's told this joke to a lot of stakeholders, that they also wanted him to put bike racks in front of an auto dealership. And he just thought that on King Street, no one is riding a bike, it's all automobiles, no one is walking to his dealership, and in his world, coming from his perspective,
right,
this was another, red tape bureaucracy telling him what he had to do. So that's another example of my trying to say, gee, I would have dealt with Chip in a different way. I would have completely dealt with him in a different way. And I have dealt with him for 2 years and did very well. So it's all how you try to accomplish your goal when you're dealing with certain types of people. That's all.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, we need to.
Fairly new to Northampton, Terry, and I'm just curious about how many businesses are there here in Northampton?
There are probably 100 stores and shops in downtown.
Uh-huh.
There are probably about 15 to 16 manufacturing firms here. There's not a lot of office. Probably dozens of professional dental, legal, mental health, psychology venues. There's a lot of, state of Massachusetts does not, unfortunately, give you numbers of businesses per community. What they do is they give you ranges of 0 to 50, 50 to 100, 100 to 200, and that is worthless. There are other entities that will tell you there are hundreds of businesses Northampton, because any one person who fills out a DBA could be considered a business. So it's a big moving target.
but speaking from a core perspective, there's definitely minimum 100 shops in downtown, businesses, restaurants, and then 12 to 15 very substantial manufacturing firms in the city. And probably dozens and dozens of other types of ancillary businesses, so.
I was just curious in terms of thinking if we ever were to do any type of direct outreach to businesses about how many are we talking about.
It's a small community.
Commission, which is interesting.
It's not thousands and thousands.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like if we did want to do some sort of public education, that we would definitely either run it by you or have you play some kind of role, since you are developing personal relationships with, and you've mentioned a couple of times how those personal relationships go really far in you achieving your goal without pushing people's back against the wall. So that's definitely, I think, a goal of ours, is to elevate that level of not just mild, you know, approval of trees, but I think that we want to get people to really get enthusiastic about trees and really appreciate the value and be willing to put some resources on it.
I think the Gazette does an excellent job of covering all the issues in the city, and they do a really, they take an interesting priority in highlighting emerging and small businesses in the city, and they do it on a weekly basis almost. I would think that if you approach them at some point about your message, your goals, plans for the next year, 2 years, or 3 years, that you're going to get a receptive audience to that kind of a story, and that becomes a predicate for sending your message out to the retail business ownership community as to what you're trying to accomplish, and it starts to inform them about the value of it, and hopefully leads to, you know, support and acceptance to what you're trying to do. I mean, if you encounter opposition from the business community, please let me know. I mean, I'm happy to talk to those opponents and try to understand the nature of their resistance and see if there's ways to convince them, you know, to be supporters. Because I believe it is in their interest to see a green downtown.
All right. Well, thank you for joining us.
Sure.
So this is just the first start of hopefully a conversation that will continue. And it's really nice knowing that you're in lockstep with us.
Oh, definitely.
So thank you for
thanks, Terry.
Yep.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep.
All right. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean that. That was not. That was just camera.
Brought a thought to mind. You know, a way to deal with that is I've seen it in other cities where they have some sort of colored signage at the end of the street saying this business is this direction.
Yeah, I thought about that.
There's different ways of approaching that without.
Yeah, sandwich.
Down all the trees.
Yeah.
I've seen it in the board. I mean, I hate to or work for us.
Yeah.
But like, at the same time, it's like, we hope you're in the
board. Oh, I actually love that idea.
So that way, it's like you're rewarding the good behavior. It's the best. I mean, it's more work. It's something that, you know, someone has to work on, but it might be a nice way to, you know, positive direction people are doing. Very specific award, but
they did that one time though for there's a business down on Pleasant Street that they actually had this big article about it. They the city planted a tree down there, and then the business put up a metal like barrier. I think it's a karate studio or something.
Really,
yeah, I think it's a karate it's like studio or something.
Yeah,
on what street?
Yeah, it's, right
it's on Pleasant. Yeah, yeah. It's yeah. Near Roberto's.
Because oh. that's next to Hugo's and Hugo's back in.
Exactly.
Tree
yeah.
Guard.
Yeah.
It's yeah. Like an impossible location, unlikely yeah. To grow, and it's thriving.
But that just
because
your award.
So many people back out of there, and yeah. When it was a Phillips Auto Glass, and it was a little bit better
yeah.
Shop, and they were just snapping the trees in half.
Yeah.
So the former, two former highway superintendents built that, the head mechanic built that.
Oh, I thought the owner did that.
No,
the
city, we did that, it's a city
okay.
Tree.
Oh, okay.
The tree guard, so if you hit that, They actually had a smaller one, and that wasn't good enough, so they had a bigger one.
Uh-huh.
But it worked.
Yeah, it has worked.
Following up on Andrew's idea, what if, for Arbor Day, we get some kind of award?
I mean, it's cool, I mean, it's...
It's great press, it's, we can do a call for nominations.
Yep.
So we get the way ahead of time, so we get people thinking about, ooh, yeah, it's a good time for me to plant a tree.
But, you know, we have to be that way.
Yeah, I'm asterisking, because I think it's great for future discussion. All right, so we're moving on to fall planning. And I just, again, put all of this on for Alan, what's his last name? Seawall, Alan Seawall, just to make it really clear when we're doing this. But Jen and Rob, do you feel like you need to talk at all about how the volunteer crew is shaping up?
I did put them on Google Sheet, we have, so we have, we have maybe 37 altogether people who said they'll do something, you know, something like come to a meeting, and not all, but all of everything, just every planning. And,
what is your goal? What number do you need?
You know, I think we probably need a couple more, what we call leaders, or maybe a few more. But on the other hand, I haven't heard back from 3 or 4 people, so to express some interest before, so we may have enough of those. I think we could use another handful or two of volunteers, but we may already have those because, well, Myra's not here, maybe she won't be back. She was going to bring a handful from Polio.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought she said I asked her about it. She said she replied to you.
Oh, she did? Okay.
Check your inbox. Because she said that she wrote about
it. I lost it. But I will.
Check. I know she's interested.
Yeah, exactly. So she's interested. So if she comes in, of course, John. We may have about the right number of volunteers. So I just need to add it up to kind of read over the detail, figure out how many. But I don't know how many times the person's going to come. But my next email, you can ask people. It is in October, May 20th, so there's time to pick up
tomorrow. Just that we wanted to just figure it out from, you know, and if we do need, you know, more people, we can contact the Boy Scouts or, you know, I didn't know if you had a people from the tree survey.
You're already, I have a huge number of people. So we're already going to be in surplus. My question was, do we want to be strategic about the last 10 people and try to really reach out to youth or to any particular time?
That's part of why I haven't pushed ahead is that I'm thinking about, you know, who do we want? Because the mix will make a big difference in how we look going forward. We'll continue to come. Which one people have to do is important.
Do one of you want to reach out to the Northampton High Environmental Club? I mean, the thing is, today is the first day of school, so things are not going to be very gelled. Mm-hmm. But I know that there's an environmental club at Northampton High.
Right.
We could also reach out to Smith Folk Forestry Program.
I already have a relationship with Smith Folk, and my daughter goes to the high school, so I'll just contact them.
I think that would be really good, because I think part of what we're doing a lot of people who might be on the older side rather than younger.
Yeah.
And that's why Polio would be interesting. Of course, people are down there.
Right.
I have one thing that I'd like to put maybe from everybody, especially probably Rich or Renna. At least 3 people have asked me what the age minimum is.
Oh, yes.
For this. And I really don't have a sense of what would be appropriate.
The parent there.
Yeah, I think that would be a response to say.
Oh, we're going to get into parent screening now. We're in trouble.
I think to say that, you know, as long as you can take responsibility for your kid, you know, they can't let them loose on the other volunteers. I mean, I have everything down to like a nice 4-year-old that I really like once they come. you know, tree plantings have done before, a 6 and 8 year old actually came often.
Maybe stack that group with a couple more adults to fill the gap if they don't, you know.
Yeah, so I think we should maybe include the people with kids.
It's a photo op. I'll definitely put out a photo op press release when we're gonna do the actual plantings to get the Gazette to bring a photographer. So it would be great to get some kids planted and have that captured.
Okay, well, I will write them all back saying they're welcome, bring your kids and they'll be responsible.
That's not just an adult party. This is an all age group party.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I mean, there are definitely.
Must train the kids while they're young.
Absolutely.
That way they're, when we're retired, they can be sitting in these seats doing the same thing.
When I was a little chap, I planted that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we love that.
That will bring a few more volunteers, people that want to bring kids.
Great, okay.
I do have some, I did like the way that you organized the tree survey, tree inventory, where we all met at one location. And that is what we're doing through this year's group on the 12th. It's a pretty big group of people that are maybe planting trees in October. And I don't know, I think I might like to go directly to the site where there are trees to be planted. Thoughts on that, detail?
My thought would be to bring them all together in one location and do one single training and then disperse them. Hand out.
This is the general group, there won't be a training for them.
Well, but isn't there gonna be a, here are your tools, here are your trees, nothing?
I was assuming that the leaders would have the tools and know where the trees are, it would be the leaders. And it would be you, you would be somewhere on South Street. Maybe they should find a better name for it.
Let me think about that. I mean, I think there's a benefit to bringing everyone together and having this sense of this group of work. Andrew, you've done this many times, what are your thoughts?
I'm just amazed that there's that many people want to do it.
Say again?
I'm amazed that there's that many people want to do it. You know, I think it's wonderful.
Yeah, it's, I think that it's, people really want to fill in deep holes. I mean,
that's what I mean. Yeah, we've usually just had to rely on dedicated people who can show up and work and then kind of volunteers to fill it in. that's impressive.
Well, I think the list here seems real. You know, I mean, I haven't spoken to these people, but tens, you know, back and forth. And they can promise an email in the future.
So that's great.
I mean, how we do this, if we all meet in one place, that might be to people that are organized.
They can be rich, I can say a word or two. I mean, I just think that moment of coming together and feeling you're part of a team and you get inspired.
Okay.
I just think.
It'll make the organization easier.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then people could carpool. Like, it was kind of great to meet at Sheldon Field.
Uh-huh.
Just carting together and, you know, people, plus you get this feeling of like, you know, oh, it's not just three of us.
Yeah.
You know, it's this whole
right.
group of people.
Right.
You know, it's a lot of energy.
Good.
Are we talking about what's happening on the 12th?
No, we're talking about every Saturday, right?
Or yeah, there's one missing Saturday in October.
So you're saying, so every Saturday, everybody starts off together?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then you disperse, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and then we could have a folder for each leader and say, this is where the sites you're going to go to.
The reason I'm thinking this so far ahead is that I don't know who the people are that are volunteers. I don't know what they look like. They could all be 8 years old. And so if we all meet in one place, then we're just shifting around in groups to make good tree planting groups go out together.
Yeah, I agree that coming together has a benefit in terms of the coherence and sort of professional aspect to it with the location.
And you can come up with an inspiring quote.
All right, read it. I already
All right. Heard it. And one other thing, I think there will be some findings that are on the schedule. This is a lot of people. There are people who want to working in the economy. I assume that personally was finding president.
One other thing I want to ask is if we end up after the site tour and all of this site identification we're going to do over the next couple of years. We come up with more than 160 sites, and we have requests for setback plantings. Can I donate trees to Shade Trees Northampton for setback plantings that don't have to be accepted by city council and la-di-da-di-da, and then have our trees prioritized, city trees prioritized on public right-of-way spots?
Well, I mean, if it's a setback planting, and people don't have to, don't sign that agreement that the city tree, at least you just give them the tree, that would...
You just gave them the tree and it's their tree.
Right.
There was no setback planting, no setback. So we're not involved, so that means the trees don't pass from Rob to the city, which would be similar to what you're trying to...
That's kind of what I'm trying to achieve.
So if you gave them to Rob, and then Rob just said...
Okay, you're there.
But Rob, you'll take responsibility for seeing that they're planted properly?
Right.
Okay, great.
Well, I would use some of these same people.
Sure.
To plant them.
Yeah.
So they would be planted in more or less the same way. But they wouldn't sign the agreement with the city, and they wouldn't go on the city for 2 years.
The other thing I just want to ask is, is at least one of you planning on being a floater during those days where you're not actually there?
It looks like Jim.
Yeah, we had talked about that, because there's going to be like various stuff is going to come up, or trash, you know? You're going to have like pots or pieces of burlap or wire or whatever. And I would be happy to, you know, just be, you know, zooming around. Because there may be questions. I mean, you could certainly field some of the questions, but if you're over on the other side of town, you know...
I think what we should do is to make communication. Probably have to issue the handle radio. Use our repeater system. That Saturdays are pretty quiet, so there's not really much need to be driving. So that'll be helpful. So if you have a problem, or if one of us has a problem, you can come to the site. Communication is key. The other thing too is that Rob and I went looked at some of these trees at Bigelow, and some of these balls are big.
Are they?
Yes.
Yeah.
They are. Good size.
So we need to pre-position those.
Yeah, so it's going to require some coordination on my part to get the trees there for each weekend planting, probably the Friday before. Mm-hmm. The other thing too is I took the liberty of purchasing a skid steer. I actually purchased a 36-inch auger and auger setup for a skid steer.
Oh, right.
So that'll make our lives easier doing the larger trees. So we could actually go around and the larger trees, we could actually just bore, you know, the hole at it, you know, at an estimated depth without taking the tree apart, basically. And then that way there we can actually create more soil out of the tree. So the base is somewhat firm, we roll the tree in there. And then you have all that soil there sitting to use for your backfilling and your donut and your shaping. So that, and I also bought... It's on order, it hasn't come yet, but it's a forklift on the front of that thing. That's hydraulics. I tried to find, they used to make an attachment that actually used to wrap around the ball and burlap, but Bobcat doesn't manufacture anymore. So that way there, it's going to aid us to be able to dispense. Let's say we do 20 ball and burlap trees, I can actually dispense them all in one day on Friday. So I'm not doing it 2 days in a row, and then the trees will be right there at the location. Hopefully the holes drilled. And with the skid steer, it's much easier than trying to do them with a backhoe, because the backhoe, you have to have all the setup for the machine in the street. It requires me to walk, you know, parking signs out. And this way here, we can drive right on the sidewalk, drill a hole.
It's fast.
Go to the next one. So it just aim up. If that's what we want to do, it will just aid us in actually being able to get these trees in the ground. Because I really think we should put them all in the ground.
That should be our highest priority.
Especially those big, those are, you're not going to get them.
No.
I also have a large ball cart at my job.
That's good. And we have one as well, so that'll be good.
So do you two feel like you're not too overwhelmed with handling all of the millions of details in terms of making packets for groups of people? Like, does this feel manageable to you? Are you okay?
You know, luckily, one of the persons that volunteered was part of a program like this in Washington, D.C. for the years and says that you will go over our plan for this, because I don't, I am feeling that it will be, but.
Yeah, good, great. This is Suzanne?
Suzanne, yeah.
Yeah.
It's been different for something like years, and the program sounds like it was really similar.
Case of Trees. She is a volunteer for Case of Trees.
Yeah, exactly, and they obviously have, they have a system.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so she's part of, so she was, she missed calling me today and talking, you know, we're gonna get together.
Because I don't call it a big city, it's.
I think we don't, I have to work further with Rich and Anna about how we're gonna get water at each site. I know how we're gonna get water, and use that, we have hoses, and hopefully homeowners, not the homeowners' doors, but we need probably some barrels and.
Yeah, remember we all talked about how we have water barrels?
So I'm gonna maybe get, you have.
I have five, 55 gallon drums.
And I have six, well, four.
The other question that I still am not totally clear about is tools. Are we?
I've got three.
You've got three.
Asking the leaders to bring tools, or do you guys have a lot of tools?
We have a lot of tools, we can provide tools.
Really?
Okay, so we shouldn't really worry.
Yeah, no, we can just provide a set of tools that we just reuse every weekend. Just at that, at the distribution time, we meet every Saturday. You know, we'll allocate X amount of tools for each leader. They're responsible, they're responsible for bringing them back to the location.
So you have like bolt cutters, baskets, all that kind of stuff?
Those are the kind of logistic things that kind of maybe we need to sit down.
Yeah.
Yeah, once we need to.
Talk about all those things.
Yeah, yeah.
And you want sharp knives for being able to cut root systems, right?
Cut what?
Root systems.
Yeah, yeah.
They're really.
There need to be mat knives to include or maybe.
Okay, so we should try to schedule a time to get together. I do have to say that, like, this is the beginning of my semester, so like, my pants are on fire like the first month and a half, so. So I can, you know, feel the emails that keep coming in and respond to people, but, and I certainly can be there on, I think, almost all the days. Jay and I are gonna do, gonna get together with you for the 12 people or something before that, to do the training for the leaders. Yeah, I personally don't have a ton of extra time to, like, you know, make lists and, I mean, I certainly can meet and say, this is what I'll do, but, yeah, I think.
What we can do is we can probably create a list via email, right, just pass it around, add to it, things that materials need.
Start a Google Doc, not an email, a Google Doc, because then we're institutionalizing, it's a forever document, and. See, I'm hoping that all these things will become a manual, like a volunteer manual, so that we don't have to reinvent the wheel.
Same format of Google Doc, or are there other formats than this spreadsheet?
A spreadsheet is great, because then your spreadsheet can just be, you know, a column of tools to bring, a column of, you know, informational material.
This is giving details, but is there, I mean, I'm putting all these into the spreadsheet, is there a way of looking at the spreadsheet, the addresses, and putting them on the email?
You can just copy and paste the.
A whole column? You can copy the column. Okay, I feel better, because I thought, I can't do this.
No, you don't have to.
Yeah, so the packets, you know, that kind of detail, both Rob and I talked about maybe, it's a young woman from, can't remember, from Mountain Oil?
Mira?
Yeah.
Think of Mira.
Mira, oh, good. You know, I personally feel like we could probably use one more person who could do some of the, you know, down the road.
Well, okay.
Good light.
Where her semester just started.
Right, you know, to, I don't know how you feel.
She was better organized.
Yeah, well, just like.
Naturally disorganized person, so, oh, I'm willing to do a lot of work, you know, but probably need, having someone like her, like, keep kind of straight and narrow.
Well, yeah, she actually has got pretty good attention to detail, I've noticed, and so that she, that kind of thing might come naturally to her. She is just starting school. I can certainly email her and just say, hey, we could use another person to sort of help with the organizing part of this. Mm-hmm. Are you able to be that person?
Mm-hmm. It's just, I can just see, you know, all right, make these packets, you know what I mean? Like that I probably will not.
What is the packet?
Well, you had just mentioned.
You know, we're going to have, here's the leader, here's the people in the leader's group, here's the list of tools that you want to make sure you have at the end of the day, here's the addresses, you know, just, you know, something like that, you know what I mean?
We need to talk to them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I
Yes.
I'll contact her and ask to see if she'd be willing to do that. And then making copies, can that happen at DPW?
Copies of the pack.
Okay, anything else about?
Well, I do have one other question, just for, I don't know a lot about this kind of thing, but is there a way to make, could we make a doodle poll? So we have all these volunteers and we have these dates. Is there a simple way to contact them without emailing and then getting their email back and then writing it down? Like, to make a doodle poll and have people just sign up for when they can do it?
I hadn't approached that problem yet.
Yeah.
But that is a problem.
I'm just trying to streamline the amount of, like.
But I don't know the days that those people are committed to this, that they're volunteer.
Right, well, that's what I'm saying. If we could send them a doodle poll, you know, when, these are the dates, you know, we said we're going to get back to you soon about the details. So we can, you know, we can, in that email that's attached to the doodle poll, say.
So, Lily, you're going to help with the doodle poll?
I can create a doodle poll if you want. So, and I have access to that. If you could just make it really clear, a column that says these people are just volunteering to plant, not confused with the leaders. Although, have you already gotten commitments from leaders? Do you know that?
I haven't, but I'll call them to do it. It's all there.
Okay, all right.
I mean,
yeah.
It's a little early to send it in, because.
Yeah, well, not really.
Get them to, like, pencil in the.
Well, might have to send it again, some new people come on. Like.
You can do it in batches, you already have a list of people who are committing, so.
Right.
And then anybody else who's serving can fill in.
Yeah, I mean, on here, this is volunteers, it says on the right-hand side, it kind of gives you an idea of what I think of their level, what you said. There are a few that just say water only. That's all.
I might see if Mira wants to take that piece on.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I will email you. I think there should be a small, just an intro details. You don't need to bring your own tools. We'll have tools. We're going to all meet at, I guess we need to decide where we're going to meet.
Yeah, you need to go along with the doodle poll or just in advance of the actual?
Well, I guess we don't need to go along with the doodle poll.
No, I don't think we do.
Okay, never mind. We can do that later.
Okay. All right. I mean, I think this doodle poll is like great, but you're going to volunteer. You're volunteering, tell us when you're there.
Right.
Okay. So sort of, it's not.
And we're thinking 9 to noon on Saturday mornings?
What's the consensus now?
How many?
9 to noon? That's late, I know.
How many trees per group?
I thought 3 or 4. And again, I was going to ask Suzanne what she thought about shades.
3 or 4 for a group of health companies?
3.
And how many individual groups?
8.
On a given Saturday.
8 groups. So we're talking 24 trees. Now, I think some groups will go faster than others. I didn't know you were going to have a sauger, but, you know, start
well,
the whole.
I didn't say anything.
I know.
I just was thinking about this.
But that would shift me more to 4, I think, than 3. But
just the time constraint wise, I'm trying to have individuals try to dig up. You know, I don't know if we can dig all those holes in that time frame. It'll be a mix.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Prioritize the big balls.
Yeah, we're going to do the bigger ones in the ground, and then we can take as we're going along. So the problem is that we've taken all the trees that are all burlap, and the ones that are in containers, which are larger than the grow bag trees. So the grow bag trees are real simple. Folks can just dig their hole and do that themselves. We don't really need auger for the other trees. Use the auger or
Well, that's what I think we might be lacking, a whole bunch of people who are really strong. I know us older folks can be really strong, but some of them aren't.
What you might want to do is 3 to 4, and then maybe if you find out after the first Saturday that people are done in 45 minutes, that you have a little bit, a few backup.
Yeah.
So
there's one other piece that I'm just realizing, whoa, this is an organizational thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Is it our intention to match every individual tree we have, species, size, whatever, with a particular site before, you know, before you
The goal would be once, so all these locations that I have mapped out on Google Map,
yep.
I'm going to have to go and revisit. I have a lot of them for knowledge, but I have to revisit the locations. But most of the places that are on there are suitable for tree plantings.
Right, but are you thinking tulip poplar here, so where is that information going to be lodged?
That information will be on the Google Doc.
It's going to be on that map?
Yes, eventually, but that's after I start to go out. So whatever information we gather tomorrow, whatever we decide to do with that information, that's going to be put on there, and that'll be just another set of places. And we'll have all this information, and we've got to prioritize what we want to plant things. The problem with prioritizing things is that you may not have the right species at that location, based on the utilities. The other problem is that when I put the stake in the ground, I have big stake in the ground, if, you know, there's water and sewer in the way, or if there's natural gas in the way, which you're going to find in a lot of locations, we have to do alternative thinking. I don't have an issue with planting trees over gas mains. I've done it many times, they're 30 inches deep. Older gas mains are in the street. The newer gas mains are in the tree belt, so, yeah.
Is it possible to get a list of the trees that have been purchased?
Yep.
So it seems to me like there's a good, and maybe this is what your crew is doing ahead of time, so clarify. But it seems like there's at least a really good day or two where you are thinking about how to cluster trees at the wherever you're holding them so that they can efficiently go to the right sites.
Yeah, I just have a little nursery to tell an apple, depending on which trees are where. We're able to drive down the roads and pull them off and put them on a truck, a trailer, and drop them off at the site the day before.
Oh, okay.
So depending upon
your crew has got that covered.
Yeah, so depending upon how we do the first Saturday, depending upon how many trees we get planted, we'll have more knowledge of how we're going to do the following Saturday based upon what we have and how long it takes. And I also, you know, talk to the crew about having them participate as well. So they, some of them, not all of them, probably will participate. At least somebody will participate. Because I mean, logistically, we need to have people there to drive equipment on meeting that day. Plus, if we're going to water them with the jet rotter, I need someone that has a license and all that stuff. So
this, be able to drive the truck with the water. Yeah.
So this will be all part of that discussion that we have about logistically about all of that.
Okay.
And if we don't finish, trees can sit there until or whatever.
If we don't finish, we'll plant.
Yeah, that was kind of the plan. Like, if we don't get them done in October, there was still November.
Well, I mean, the next day,
if we don't get them in the ground.
We're all like the next day.
Got
all
it. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll have to plant. I don't think it's
Right. And yeah, I can't stay the long period.
Well, that could be a course, that could be the radio coordination. We need five people to stay on X neighborhood.
Yeah, who can do it?
Who can do it? Yeah. Some people might do it.
Right.
So I think.
All right.
Okay. I want to move on.
We have one more question.
Okay.
So you use gelscape with your planting?
We have not gelscape.
Is that something we should consider?
Yes.
There's not gelscape.
Polymer that was developed at UMass. Put it in the planting hole, and when you get it wet, it expands and holds the water in place, so the roots have it a little longer. I think it really helps the trees. And no other amendment to that plan?
I use mycorrhizae, combination mycorrhizae and soil. When we did our trees on our own, we actually would have a pile of soil that we made. It was amended.
Yeah.
They had mycorrhizae already mixed in it. But I didn't want to get too far off the path because the tree has to live in the native soil that's there.
Yeah.
Just in order to get the roots to get established and have some soil that's not just like bony, kind of terrible back in the hole, which dries out very quickly.
Okay.
All right.
Onward. Doing good work. I'm very pleased to see how this is all coming together. Marilyn, did you have anything further you wanted to say about the community survey before we go on to the to-do list?
Well, just that Nero and Lily and I got together Sunday night just to finalize the survey, 10-question survey. Three of the questions were just simple. Are you a property owner or do you rent? The rest were ranking questions of values of trees, there were a few questions that allowed folks to respond in a comment box. So it had already been approved by the mayor, but we just went over it, did some reorganizing, tested it, and, you know, was sent out, and what, you know, over 100 responded so far?
200.
Wow, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Do you have to then hand, like, hand?
There's some, there's no, it generates some, like, bar graphs and so forth of our few quantitative questions, but most of our questions are not quantitative. They're open-ended replies, which are great. It's gonna be a big job to analyze the data, but it'll be so worth it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and I had suggested to Lily, just because I've seen this work well in other committees and groups where I've been in, at the end of the meeting, just to have somebody, and I often do it for this one, I can do it every one, or we can circulate the task, just to create a to-do list. So I'll just review what I have documented. If I missed anything, let me know, or maybe it needs to be omitted. And what I'll do when I get home is I'll type this up and remind me. Should I send it to you, Lily? Or the whole group, or create a Google Doc? What would you recommend?
I'm thinking about this. I guess I like it on a Google Doc, and we can just keep adding it to the same document. And it can just be, you know, a new date put on there.
So this is just a to-do for all?
To do between now and the next meeting.
Oh.
And then if anything is not done, then it gets carried over. It's a good way to just keep things moving, because, you know, sometimes, you know, things just slip in your mind. But if we have a document, not only for us personally to refer to, but then as a group, we refer to it at the end of each meeting, at the beginning of each meeting, as part of our agenda. So I'll just read these. Let me know if I missed anything. So Lily's going to send the meetings to us commissioners. She's going to invite Chris Mason.
Minutes.
Minutes. What did I say?
Meetings.
To send the minutes on the meetings.
Meetings.
She's going to invite Chris Mason to come to a meeting. She's going to create a watering information document and create a Google poll for the planning alternatives. Rich, I
Wait,
have.
Wait, what was the last one?
Okay, Google poll?
Yes.
Rich is going to follow up with Wayne regarding the $26 to sign up for a one-month SurveyMonkey called DigSafe and send us the trees purchased for planting, or at least have it so that we can refer to by the committee. And then this may not be between now and the next meeting, but have Andy partly the mail from cash to planting for 1 year. Jen's going to reach out to Smith Group for volunteers. Rob and Jen are going to work with Suzanne as well as Mira to review the timeline, planning, and logistics and tools, and continue working on this planning plan. And Jen and Rich are going to do a training of the leaders on September 12th, which is before our next meeting on the 16th.
It's Jay.
Except Jay, yep.
Yeah, Jay and Jen.
Jay and Jen, yep.
Yeah. Search does not have to work that Saturday.
Yeah.
You're welcome to come, but.
Oh. The 12th. And then tomorrow, Rich, Todd, Lily, and Jay are doing the drive around for the sighting. And lastly, all of us are going to look at the map from Rich on the proposed and accepted tree planting locations. That all sounds.
The only other thing we need. The only other thing we need is a confirmed site. Because the training's the 12th, so that's like a week from Saturday.
Yeah, so that's
we need a confirmed, confirmed site to do the training.
Okay. Who's gonna do that?
Well, tomorrow morning you had asked us that when we go on our site tour to be looking for a site.
Yeah, yes.
So, all right.
So
just because we're going to have to communicate that to the leaders to show up.
Confirmed site.
Look for a site for 9 to 12 training, and then you got to do that tomorrow.
Yeah, just like a place to.
Yeah.
Jay,
okay.
Trees or something.
Should also put on there that Jen and I need to get together before the 12th.
Yes.
And stand out.
Yes.
Ridge Road dinner, like, we'll review what you know.
Well, I think we're gonna put it like Earth, and someone can create a Google Doc, or I can create a Google Doc for the things that we need.
Yeah.
And just email you the link.
Yeah.
And then we'll just keep adding, compiling stuff to it, and then we'll just figure out how it's all gonna get to where it has to be.
Yeah.
As part of the planning, so that's the tool documents.
Yeah.
Documents, all the tools.
Tools and supplies, I guess we should say. School supplies, equipment, I guess we should.
Okay.
Right.
It's a lot of stuff. Rich, you want me to get a box, Chelsea? I'll be Northern Nurseries, closest place to get it. Big box.
Big one.
You probably might just maybe have some thoughts.
Does it come at juice, like what, if it happens?
It's a lot cheaper to buy.
It is, and then we could just separate it in the Ziploc bags or something.
I'm sorry, Marilyn, by the way, I think this is really helpful.
Okay, great, yeah.
Yeah, fabulous.
It helps me to just.
Yeah. Right, thank you. Did you mention that Richard's gonna inquire about the 26 dots, starting?
Yes, yeah.
Got it.
I'm gonna do my own.
All right. Can we move on to our last item on the agenda, which is any other business?
Okay, thanks.
All right, I'm gonna wait until we're all here together.
I apologize, I've been emailing Attorney Seawall back and forth about the issue of 91 Spring Street. We're trying to move on that today, so he's been, you know, I've been working.
Yeah.
So I'm not ignoring anyone.
Okay, no worries. Okay, the last thing that I wanted to add to any other business was just this letter to the editor that came the other day, yesterday, I guess, by Ken Dim, who came to the very first meeting that we held, and who has personally lobbied me prior to that, probably three or four times, about his concern over the village entry. So I would like to just, I emailed Wayne to see where in the planning board is with this. I haven't heard back from him yet. But I proposed the idea of having some kind of letter of response, and I did hear from a couple of you, Andrew and Jay, that they liked the idea of us responding in some way that, not necessarily to that particular thing, although we could certainly allude to it, but just an opportunity to clarify for the public what our role is, where, you know, where the city is, and, you know, taking a fresh look at the value of trees. So I would like to know how others feel and whether or not we have a volunteer to draft such a letter.
I think it would be good to get to express to the public what our role is. We're not decision makers. You know, find out where the planning board is, if they've made a decision, if we can influence that decision.
I ask those questions. Go through those, by the way. I just haven't heard back.
And also, as Andrew mentioned, just to wish the public in private, what is the distinction? Spell it out, it's pretty interesting.
I mean, they are talking about private trees, right?
Yep.
So we actually.
But people might think that that's part of our duty.
Well, he actually, and the letter said, I think it's ironic that the DPW is planting all these trees when
other trees are
a bunch of trees
down.
Are about to come down. So I also felt like, well, does he understand that the DPW has no control?
No, I think it's a lot of just lack of education.
Yeah.
Those ones, those responsible.
Something to clarify in the paper. In fact, the reason the DPW needs to plant a lot of trees is trees are being taken. We need to keep as many trees as we can, and those are trees that are not necessarily long.
I think it's important for us to say that we actually do have an affirmed commitment to retaining mature trees where possible,
yeah.
but that our jurisdiction is
right.
Shade trees.
Right.
However, having said that, I think it would also be okay to say, without promising anything, that we're zooming out really far and looking at all the ways in which the city can protect its tree canopy, including zoning and any kind of zoning regulations that relate to trees and you know, I want to be careful that we don't word it in such a way that we're promising any future ordinances that strengthen that. But on the other hand, I do think it's worth saying that we're thinking about those questions.
Clear, we don't have jurisdiction, but we're thinking about those questions.
And that we're an advisory board that would offer, after, you know, after doing a lot of research and considering what other municipalities are doing, that we would offer recommendations about how to strengthen our overall protection of trees.
Yeah, I think the beginning of the, I
don't know.
Yeah, I'm seeing the eyebrows, so go for it.
No,
when this came up before.
Well, number one, I never think you should respond to a letter to the editor.
Really?
I'll let it go.
What about an opt-in brief?
And I also tend to think that perhaps the best way to convey that would be reaching out to whoever's writing the story on the upcoming event and making sure that gets in there prominently somewhere in the larger news piece.
Okay, I'm actually going to be speaking, that's interesting you mentioned that, because the journalist, while I was sitting here, said, if anything comes out of the meeting tonight, I'm not going to be able to make it, but could you give me a call? So I could certainly, and help me shape the message here, because I want to make sure that I'm getting it right when I speak to her.
I think the beginning, however it's communicated, I think that's an interesting point you have. So if and when you talk to this person, I think just because I've been a receiver now of like a lot of, some of them are rather bizarre, here we want to sell you back walnut trees I grew from seed and some other things because my name got attached to the
you're the go-to person.
Yeah, I'm getting some all kinds of calls. I can help me decide whether I should cut these trees down or like that. So I think there needs to be as much chance for public clarification of who we are and what we do. Like, I think that should be the first tier. That's
I just want to respond to what you said, because I agree that we should not have a knee-jerk response, and it shouldn't be a response that narrowly answers his letter. But as a person who for many years felt like I was on the other side of the powers that be in the city, and I felt outed, and I often felt like a stone wall went up whenever I expressed a dissenting opinion, the response was almost always no response. And that just frustrates the shit out of people. And I don't want to be those. I really want to change that culture. So I want to make this guy an ally, because that's what he is. He's an ally. He's just an ally that's coming forward at a time when we, you know, we're just getting underway. So we can't do anything to address his grievance. We can't do anything to address it. But I do want him to know and even publicly acknowledge that we hear this. And
we welcome the public asking.
And the advocacy.
Yeah.
So I think it's all, the devil's in the details. I think it's all how the letter is crafted.
I think actually you might be better off in the sense maybe to write a guest column. Instead of actually doing a letter to the editor, because it's like, you're not trying to do tit for tat with him, but I think a letter to the editor basically explaining, this is a public shade tree commission. This is our mission. You know, I don't think you all have really developed a mission statement in a sense.
Yeah.
And so we're actually just, we're like grabbing onto all these different pieces of stuff that's been kind of hanging around. Like, for example, the additional mature tree protection ordinance, that whole conversation piece. So yes, we endorse this, and that would affect projects going forward like this one, where mature trees will be looked at totally differently. We do endorse that. However, we don't have the ability to control what happens on private property because we are the public shade tree commission.
Yeah. By the way, does the mayor support that draft ordinance? Do you know?
I haven't had a conversation.
Okay. I think it would be vital that we know that before we say that we endorse it, because I think the mayor.
We have to vote to endorse it.
We sort of did.
Since your revisions.
You sent revisions.
But isn't that a de facto endorsement? Otherwise.
Depends if they take our revisions or not.
Well, that's true. Yeah, that is true. Although, was there anything, any of our revisions that if they weren't adopted, we were like, screw it, we don't want this thing? We never had that conversation.
Well, you could reword it to say that the city council offered us this form, this ordinance, and we gave them our feedback. I mean, you could just say we're involved, you know, if that's what we're communicating.
Well, I guess I'm worried on a couple levels. I don't want our hands to be forced by a letter to the editor before we're ready to come out with our mission statement. We haven't had our vision session, we don't have our mission statement. I mean, I think coming out and saying what we're tasked with, which is rather narrow, is fine, but beyond that, I'm not sure we're ready for a big, here we are. And if we get a shot, which, it's a slippery slope when you start.
Is it, sir?
Gets it up in your hand, which is why I don't call it fighting it.
Yeah, but.
Well, no, that's not true. No, the Conservation Commission, sorry, I just have to clarify. The Conservation Commission has a number of issues, sticky issues, like Kevin Lake came out with a very controversial guest article. I don't know if it was in a guest column or whether it was a letter at the end here about hunting on conservation. So there's definitely a precedent.
The only difference, though, is that you really don't have, so he has a Conservation Commission, and the Conservation Commission actually, the city owns the land, but they manage it.
Yeah.
There's a difference here. That board, that commission is different, set up differently. This commission is set up as advisory only.
Right.
So I would think that a guest column with a mission statement, what we support, you know, what we're trying to do, what you're trying to do, I should say, is collaboration together, would be more appropriate than just answering that particular letter to the editor. Because unfortunately, that whole situation, the whole situation on Hospital Hill is kind of a sticky one, and a slippery slope in a sense, because now that all these units have been built, and people are realizing that, oh, you know, we're going to lose this whole back end over here, with all this canopy cover, people are really starting to get a little hot on the collar, and I think that Villachill has kind of become its own little ecosystem in a sense.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a hot button issue, and I would have a tendency to agree with Todd that we may not want to stir that up, but we may want to present, you may want to present who you are, what your mission is, which can encompass and address, not really solve this issue, because you won't be able to.
No.
But you'll be able to address it, saying that we do here, we invite people to come to meetings, please, public input, the Survey Monkey was put out, so on and so forth. I think that would be more appropriate to address that particular concern. And you may want to time that with the same time as we do the tree plantings and the press time as well. Or after that, I don't know if you need to answer it right away.
No, I don't propose to answer it right away. I think, and I think that the coverage we're going to get at the Gazette will ride us for a period of time, and then it'll be nice to be back in the paper again. I can envision the words that would satisfy, I think, both of our visions here. And so I am willing to, and it won't be in the next, you know, 3 or 4 weeks, but to make a stab at a draft. And I'm always, you know, I just like the way you all approved the press release that I would welcome your candid input, so we just, you know, we have something that we all can get behind. And if anyone said, you know, has completely cold feet and says, I absolutely don't think we should do that, then that's fine too. But I think it's an opportunity. I envision it being as can of worry as you do, because I just don't, I can imagine the words that do not escalate, but that actually just.
And the bigger can of worms.
Make people feel better.
Like, no response, as you said, really could create negativity that might not get out in the public, but people could be feeling.
Well, it infuriates people. When I don't have the time to get a response to all the emails,
yeah,
with residents' complaints, you know, the first thing they're going to do is they'll email me again. If I can't get to them, they call the mayor's office and check off.
Yeah.
Why isn't Paris Labor, you know, responding? So I agree with you. I think that it would be good to address it, but it's how you address it,
yeah,
is,
yeah,
really important. And tying in everything that you're trying to accomplish would be a good way to address it using the appropriate words.
Yeah.
Well, just addressing that particular one item, I think, might not be the right, in my experience.
might be willing to work on that better when you believe just the language of it.
Okay. Does anyone have a strong objection to me making a crack at a draft?
Do you have any other, well, Todd, you said that you really, it was a good idea. What are your thoughts after the discussion?
It's fine, take a red draft.
Do people read the Gazette tend to, like, if there's a letter to the editor, people know to, like, look at the guest column? I don't know the people on that.
It's on the same page.
All right, yeah.
Yeah, it's obviously on the bottom left, so. If you read that page, yeah, you do. You usually see who wrote it, you look down, not even that, or, you know what I mean? Depending on who you are.
Okay, okay, thank you. I'm gonna adjourn this meeting, motion to adjourn, if there are no further other business. Okay, I need a motion. I need a motion from somebody other than me. So moved.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned.